It is such a privilege to be here today to moderate this conversation on public interest technology and democracy. And I particularly wanted to thank the organizers for bringing us together for this conversation and using the 60th anniversary of the passage of the Civil Rights Act of 1964 as a jumping off point for us to try to explore these themes of how we can use human rights, civil rights, and fundamental rights as a way to better understand an anchor point for how we understand what is technology in the public interest. And so the conference organizers had invited me first to start this conversation with some framing remarks, setting the table, helping us to understand the important intersection between civil rights and public interest technology and democracy, and then to allow our wonderful panelists to introduce themselves, share some of their thoughts and perspectives of this topic, and then we're going to go into questions and then open it up to Q&A. So the conference organizers asked me to tell a little bit about my story and my interest in public interest technology and in civil rights. So I am a constitutional law scholar and researcher at William & Mary Law School, but I see myself first and foremost as a civil rights attorney. I spent 10 years of my career in the Civil Rights Division of the U.S. Department of Justice, but my first day in the Civil Rights Division was September 10, 2001, a day before the terrorist attacks. And in the 10 years that I spent in the Civil Rights Division as serving as a policy liaison with the Department of Homeland Security and with the White House Homeland Security Council, I increasingly saw the convergence of the way in which the government increasingly relied on data collection, aggregation, storage, and analytics in order to make critical decision-making, including automated decision-making, using algorithmic decision-making tools as well as AI in order to conduct risk assessments. And as a result of those 10 years, I decided to, once I entered the academy, focus my research on the intersection of race, technology, law, and power. And increasingly, that research is focused on AI and AI governance. But part of why I feel like my research agenda and this topic of public interest technology and democracy is so urgent is because of what we saw on January 6th. I don't know about you, but it shook me to my core. And when I saw the Confederate flag waving in the Capitol Rotunda, it really propelled me into some soul searching on why I became a civil rights attorney in the first place. When I decided to go to law school and become a civil rights attorney, it was because, quite frankly, I was born and raised in Kansas. And I didn't know it at the time, but when I was 7 years old and my family walked into a McDonald's and they refused to serve us a Happy Meal, my father asked to speak to the manager. And he said to the manager, "This is not just and this is not right." And I was so embarrassed and I just really wanted to leave. And I said, "Dad, we don't need that Happy Meal." But he turned me into a civil rights lawyer that day. And then when I was in high school, I remember one of my teachers walked up to me and said, "I don't like you because of the way you look, and I know that's wrong. I know that I'm filled with discrimination, but I'm going to try to overcome it because that's the right thing to do." So being born and raised in Kansas showed me discrimination, all the hundreds of instances of discrimination that I saw to myself, to my family, to my friends, but I also saw the power of opportunity and equality, including that teacher who wanted to fulfill what they saw as the American dream. So I went to law school to be a civil rights lawyer because I recognize I'm a woman of color. I'm a daughter of immigrants. My parents escaped the communist revolution. My father received his PhD in engineering from Kansas State University. He was offered a faculty position. He told my mother, "I cannot accept it. I cannot turn my back on thousands of years of our culture, our language, our family name. I cannot do it." My mother said, "You will do it because our children will grow up in a democracy. So you will take that position and you will turn your back on thousands of years of your language, your culture, your name, your family name." And so I became a civil rights attorney. And I wanted us, on this historic moment where we're still counting the votes of this historic election, to think about what my mother hoped for by having her children grow up in a democracy, and that is to think about not only the 60th anniversary of the Civil Rights Act of 1964, but to think about the combination of laws that led to what is referred to as the Second Reconstruction. Not only the Civil Rights Act of 1964, but the Voting Rights Act of 1965, and the amendments to the Immigration and Nationality Act of 1965. My father came to the United States in 1965. If he would have come to the United States before, the Chinese Exclusion Act and the National Origins Act would have made it impossible for my family to become US citizens. And that Second Reconstruction was made possible by the First Reconstruction. So the enactment of the 13th, 14th, and 15th Amendment as a result of the Civil War led to the ability for us to end slavery, to create the Equal Protection Clause under the 14th Amendment, and to create voting rights under the 15th Amendment. The Gettysburg Address, 161 years ago, was often referred to as a second declaration of independence because it was Lincoln trying to re-envision the Constitution to be more inclusive. And now are we on the brink of being able to think about the opportunity that we have here at this summit to create another reconstruction, another vision of our Declaration of Independence together. So I wanted to end with the quote that's so famous from our Declaration of Independence, that we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, and that they're endowed by their creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. That to serve these rights, governments instituted among men, deriving their just power from the consent of the governed. And I think that that's why we're here today. We're here today because we understand the power of the consent of the governed. We understand the power of that election. We saw a concession yesterday. We saw in the peaceful transition of power. And we saw that candidate state very clearly that your vote is your voice, and your voice is your power. And we have all come here today for the summit because I think that we understand that. You voted with your feet, you're logging on online because you understand that power. So I've now shared my story. It's very difficult. Thank you to Pitt UN, thank you to New America, thank you for inviting me to share my story. But my story is not what is significant. What democracy is about is that my story is commingled with your story and the story of Deirdre and the story of Melinda. So I now want to hand it over to both of you to help share some of your story before we go to the questions.
Thank you. So first, thank you so much to Anne-Marie for opening it up and for that really fabulous video and with Andrine's closing remarks in that video, which I think summed up so much to kind of pull on the threads that Margaret just set out. I'm Deirdre Mulligan. I'm a professor at the School of Information. I'm on this panel, I think, both because I've had a long history in the field of public interest technology before it was a thing. And just to do a little storytelling, I'm not going to go all the way back to my childhood, although there is a emphasis in my family on you have to both do good, not just do well, that I think is a little rooted in Jesuit traditions in my family. But when I was coming out of law school as a public interest law scholar, so while I was in, I went in, I had a cohort, public interest law scholars at Georgetown. We were working in all different fields, but we all had a commitment to using the tools of law as part of social change. And for we might have had slightly different visions of what social justice required, but we were there because we were interested not in serving a private interest, but in serving some version of the public interest and centering public values and the public good. For me, that ended up being very much focused right from the start on the intersection of civil rights and civil liberties and technology. I worked at the ACLU, which even in 1994, I had a privacy and technology project as part of their legislative office in DC. And it's where I really understood the ways in which we could use law and technology both to design more just futures, that we could actually co-create technical systems that reflected and embedded the values that we historically have really thought about the tool of law in advancing. Shortly after graduating from law school, I had the immense privilege of getting to help start the Center for Democracy and Technology, where I worked for many years and then was on the board. And again, the Center for Democracy and Technology was one of the early organizations to have a chief technology officer. Even as a lawyer, I was working in technical standard setting bodies, the World Wide Web Consortium, the Internet Engineering Task Force, because before the code is law was cool, we understood that the architecture of our digital platforms and our infrastructures mattered to the extent we were able to understand the equity implications of different decisions. We were able to protect and make choices that reflected privacy or security needs. And so we were very interested in co-creating a digital future out of the tools of technology as well as the tools of law. And that was a pretty heady period of time, the mid-90s to early 2000s. We had lots of laws that we passed, and we also developed lots of important technical standards that still are really robust components of values infrastructure on the internet. The past 18 months, I had the immense privilege of serving as the Principal Deputy U.S. Chief Technology Officer in the White House Office of Science and Technology Policy. And I led the tech team, which was responsible for a range of work within OSTP's mandate. There's lots of other things that I had only a tiny bit to do with, but that included our work on AI, our work on web accessibility, work on spectrum and broadband. And it was an immense privilege both to bring in the knowledge of this community, because a lot of what I did was draw on the insights from the research community and make them digestible in policy processes so that we could affect the ways in which those things rolled out, but also just collaborating across the administration and providing advice to the president and his senior advisors about the policy choices that could help us make sure that the public's rights and the public good was centered in the design of our future.
Thank you so much, Deirdre. Melinda?
All right, thank you. Well, as I was listening to both of you, I found myself inspired. So this morning we were tasked with learning something and meeting people and being inspired. So I feel like I've gotten off to a good start with that inspiration. So thank you. So my name is Melinda Jackson. I am a professor of political science here at San Jose State University and currently serve as the Dean of Undergraduate Education. I joined the faculty here in 2005 and have really just seen this campus and university community transform over that time, and just very excited about our future. During my time here, I also served for 8 years as the director of a survey and policy research institute that we had here on campus. And we had a telephone survey lab, and we did survey research. We worked with community partners, including the City of San Jose, the Hispanic Foundation of Silicon Valley, and many others. We also did research for faculty members to gather data for their research projects. And I mention this because we've just had an election, and polling always gets a lot of attention during the election. And as I was doing that survey research and telephone polling on various, you know, various public policy and public opinion topics, including some election polling, the technology was changing. And we were having these discussions about, do we include cell phone numbers in our samples, right? And how do we include them? And if we're targeting a specific geographic area, well, that's not gonna work so well anymore because somebody's area code for their cell phone might be very different from where they live, right? So that was one challenge that we were dealing with. Of course, fast forward to 2024, and, you know, who has a landline still, right? If raise of hands, I mean, probably no. Oh, okay, we got a couple. All right. Yeah, there you go, exactly. So the challenges associated with something like public opinion polling, which is very important, and election polling, have a lot to do with how technology is changing and how our information environment is changing. So if we're thinking about how we can accurately measure public opinion, we need to know how can we reach people and how can we do this within the regulations that do exist. So for example, there was also the auto dialing technology, which allowed, you know, the computers to dial many, many numbers at the same time, and then if somebody picks up, then it clicks through and you can complete the call. You're all familiar with this from, you know, robocalls and things like that. But given the laws at the time, there was a lot of debate about whether that was legal and allowed to do that when you were calling people's cell phones, for example, okay? So there were a lot of interesting questions that emerged around this intersection of technology and measuring public opinion, which is a basic foundation of information that we need in a democracy, right? We need to understand what people think about the issues in order to understand whether our policies are aligning with public interests, and then how to hold our government accountable. So that's just one example of, although my scholarship has not focused on technology in particular, in all of our areas, I think, the impact of the technological development on how we gather information and measure things is highly relevant. So anyway, thank you for being here today and inviting me to be a part of the panel.
Well, thank you so much. And thank you so much to San Jose State University for hosting this wonderful summit. So Deirdre, you've had such a huge impact on technology. And thank you for all of the years of service, not only as an academic, but a leader in civil society, Center for Democracy and Technology, and now recently in the Biden-Harris administration with your work in the White House Office of Science and Technology Policy. So I wanted to start with that, bringing us back to the Civil Rights Act of 1964. And now we're at the 60th anniversary, and you had a historic opportunity to be a part of trying to shape technology governance in OSTP, and would love to hear your thoughts on how a rights-based governance approach was taken on.
Sure. So even before I got there, I was kind of watching the administration with some level of awe, and it's for things like equitable data. Right, the fact that we don't just want to make commitments to rights, we actually want to be able to measure our performance along different dimensions that are important for equity and justice. And right from day one, the administration launched an equitable data working group that thought really rigorously, and there were new statistical policies adopted, you know, at the Census Bureau and Commerce, but really thinking about how we use data to make sure that any program we're launching, you know, whether it's the bipartisan infrastructure law or the CHIPS Act, whatever it is, making sure that the distribution of funds align with our understanding of what it means to serve all Americans. And so using data, as you said, to make good on our commitments to equity and justice. Shortly before I got there, before ChatGPT and LLMs had everybody talking about AI, Alondra Nelson had shepherded through, with the help of Alexander McGilvery, who was my predecessor at OSTP leading the tech team, the blueprint for an AI Bill of Rights. And this was the first thing the administration did on AI. And what did it do? It said our policy is gonna center protecting the public's rights, right? Think about that. The way in which we are going to approach this technology is going to be through the lens of what does it mean for our rights and what does it mean for democratic values. And that attention to thinking about the ways in which technical systems, whether the government is using them or the private sector is using them, whether we were using them in the context of public services or in the context of national security, looking at it through the lens of rights, civil rights, human rights, and its intersection with democratic values was the kind of focal point. And you can look at the AI executive order, which did many different things. It touched just about every agency because the use of technology, of AI in particular, because of its breadth and flexibility, is really touching every sector of the economy and almost every agency and government. So making sure that the regulators were updating their guidance to business, updating their regulations, using their existing tools in ways that really affirmed the commitments that we made in the Civil Rights Act, the Americans with Disabilities Act, et cetera, was an essential component of the AI executive order. But the administration wasn't just focused on telling others what to do, it was also very focused on walking the walk and being the guiding light that the United States ought to be on the global stage about how a democracy uses and refuses AI. And there are three documents that I think really tell that story of centering rights. One is the Office of Management and Budget. I know it's a very technical name. You probably don't read a lot of OMB memos, but it is the federal guidance on how agencies should use and govern AI. And it has an incredibly exacting and rigorous set of standards through which we are to evaluate AI systems. And those things don't just require kind of an evaluation of an algorithm in a lab. It requires us to actually look at what the impact is going to be, right? So taking that socio-technical lens and saying, how is this going to actually impact real people whose lives may be affected by it? So when we're talking about technology that are going to impact people's rights and safety, making sure that the principles through which it is designed and vetted and deployed and monitored reflect a commitment to our rights. Second, the National Security Memo and the accompanying framework. And I think it's worth reading just a tiny bit of the language from the National Security Memo. The OMB guidance covers AI systems that are used throughout the government. The National Security Memo on AI covers national security systems, so where AI is a component of a national security system. That means intelligence systems, et cetera. So what the document says is success for the United States in the age of AI will be measured not only by the preeminence of the United States technology and innovation, but also by the United States' leadership in developing effective global norms and engaging in institutions rooted in international law, human rights, civil rights, and democratic values. And so the final document I would point you to is the UN General Assembly resolution on artificial intelligence, which was led by the US and begins that process along with the creation of AI safety institutes and ongoing bilateral and multilateral conversations to build out those global norms that center the rights that we find in our civil rights laws.
Great, thank you so much. And Deirdre, as somebody who started your career as an advocate at the Center for Democracy and Technology, and by the way, we had such an honor being able to co-host the one-year anniversary of the release of the Blueprint for an AI Bill of Rights with OSTP, together with CDT and Data and Society, and Charlton McElwain back there, who spoke earlier today, helping to then co-host the conversation the next day at New America. We went to New America and we continued the conversation about how to operationalize the principles of the Blueprint of the AI Bill of Rights. But you've seen from there into now your journey in academia, your director of the Berkeley Center for Law and Technology, as well as serving on the faculty at Berkeley. And then you've combined that with your service in government. So you are deeply engaged in multi-stakeholder activism. And we'd love to hear your thoughts about how you can engage communities and all of these partners in trying to hold policymakers and governmental officials accountable and responsible to these communities that they serve.
Sure. So some key components of the administration's work, both of guidance to federal agencies as well as the national security memo and the framework, create new levels of transparency. As you might imagine, the transparency on the NSM side might not be quite as robust as the transparency on the kind of general federal government use of AI. But those transparency features and creating accountability structures, so every agency appointed a chief AI officer. And one of the things that we did with the release of that federal guidance was bring leaders from civil society organizations in to meet with those chief AI officers, because this is a collective activity, right? And so I think that's very important. As many of you know, what happened on Tuesday may shift the locus of action. And as somebody who's been in the tech policy space for many years, trying to advance rights and justice, I want to assure you that there are many, many partners and many places to do your work. And, you know, if Congress isn't working, the administration was a really great place. Depending upon the administration and its interest in rights-oriented frameworks, it may be that your state legislator is going to be state legislative body is going to be a more attractive place to do some of the policy engagement. But of course, the work that we do educating the people who are going to go into the private sector and into the public sector with the lenses and the skills, both the technical as well as the ethical and the legal and the social, is the way we really build out the democratic fabric in all of those institutions. So I think as educators and as institutions that engage in research and policy as well as technology transfer, I think there is still an enormous opportunity to continue our work.
Thank you so much. And Melinda, I'd like to turn to you, and you have a very also unique perspective, being Dean of Undergraduate Education, Professor of Political Science, as well as a former director of a research institute, the Survey and Policy Research Institute. So you're an expert on American public opinion and voting, and you've been able to incorporate that very deep thinking into the classroom and pedagogically. So I would love to hear your thoughts on how do you teach the importance of civil rights and that type of engagement, commitment of rights, bringing that into the classroom, especially in light of the challenges and the risks that we see in the digital age.
Yeah, thank you. So here in the California State University system, we have a requirement that all of our students take courses in American institutions. So that's a US history, US government, it's called US Constitution, and California government. And so for many years, I taught, you know, an intro to American and California government course. And one of the very first topics we always cover is the founding and the Constitution, and then that flows right into the Bill of Rights and Civil Liberties. So this is really a place where, you know, it can seem, you know, just something that happened a long time ago, and how is this relevant? But when you think about the Bill of Rights, right, these are the first 10 amendments to the Constitution, freedom of speech, freedom of press, freedom of religion, and so forth. This is one of the places where you start to see the spark and you start to see the engagement, because people do realize that it is still highly relevant to our lives. And so we start to connect it to examples of, well, what's happening in the world today that relates to freedom of speech, press freedom, freedom of religion. And we can think about things like with new technologies, the algorithms that are trained on, you know, the internet and end up embedding racial stereotypes and bias, right? You can think about the Fourth Amendment, for example. You can think about the freedom from unwarranted search and seizure and surveillance. I heard a wonderful example in the session right before lunch over in the library in the student track. It was a session on civic tech, and there was an example of the city of San Jose installing traffic cameras to catch people when they run red lights all over the city, but not perhaps taking into account that, you know, the angle of the camera included more than just the license plate. It includes the whole street, and you can see everybody's house who lives on the street and everybody who's going in and out all day long, right? Surveillance. We can think about in the current political context with the Dobbs decision and the overturning of Roe v. Wade, and more and more states imposing restrictions on access to reproductive rights. You can think about tech apps that people may use to track their reproductive cycle and who has access to that data, right? All of which gets to these questions of surveillance, having the right to control your data, having the right to opt out of surveillance. So it gets students thinking, right? Shifting to civil rights, which comes next, you know, a few chapters in the, along in the textbook, civil rights focuses less on the protections from government interference, which is what the Bill of Rights is about, and more about protections or enabling freedom to have equal opportunity and be treated equally and free of discrimination. So then we're talking about things like the algorithms. We're talking about things like algorithms that are used in jobs and the hiring process, and the fact that the tech tools that are being used will tend to perpetuate the existing power structures and hire people who quote unquote fit, right, with the existing culture and usually demographics of the organization. Another thing that we do in very deliberately in our classrooms is we focus on critical thinking, particularly in relation to political information, right? And this, we've been talking about it for many years, but we used to be talking about, you know, photos that were faked using Photoshop. Now we're talking about deep fakes, right? Where we have AI-created images and messages that are disseminated and targeted with a specific intent to misinform and perhaps influence political attitudes and behavior. Perhaps sow distrust in electoral processes, distrust in institutions like the quote-unquote mainstream media, like government, like universities. So teaching students how to evaluate that information, teaching them the skills of digital literacy is becoming more and more critical in terms of the basic foundational skills that they will need for civic engagement. I also want to mention a new initiative that our president, Teniente Mattson, has launched this year at San Jose State, and that is the Future of Humanity and Civic Engagement Initiative. And this is really putting a framework onto thinking about that intersection of technology and emerging technologies and how we participate in our democratic processes and how we engage with each other and with our government at different levels, given the changing information environment and ways that we communicate with each other. So we're excited to be launching that. It's really bringing visibility to many of the events and activities happening around campus, such as, for example, if you've been over in the library at any point, or you will be tomorrow, you will see our new Digital Humanities Center on the ground floor, which just opened this semester and is bringing together, you know, researchers and scholars and creative artists to focus on the intersection of technology and arts and humanities. So being here in the heart of Silicon Valley and being the number one producer of engineers to Silicon Valley, not Stanford, just saying, We're very proud of that. And being a minority-serving institution in which nearly half of our students are the first in their family to attend a university, and over 80% of our students are people of color, we are very committed to participating in these discussions and equipping our students with the critical thinking and ethical lenses that they're going to need as they move into the workforce.
Thank you so much. I'm going to ask one more question and then open it up to Q&A. And that question is, so in light of some of these risks and challenges that you've articulated, and also it's very inspiring to hear some of the initiatives that you've launched here, what would be some of the key takeaways of how we can build upon the Pitt UN community and as a university network in order to prioritize democracy and try to prepare our future citizenry and create the types of technological and socio-technical knowledge that they need in order to serve either as a citizen or in government or in a leadership position into the future? So Melinda, why don't we start with you, go to Deirdre, and then we'll open it up to Q&A.
Okay. I think that one of the really important roles that the university has is in bringing diverse perspectives. Here in the Bay Area, in California, in Silicon Valley, we also have a number of first and second generation immigrants who are bringing, again, different backgrounds, different life experiences, different perspectives, and bringing that to, again, wrestling with these challenges that we all face together. And so bringing the diversity of perspectives and combining that with a research focus on the emerging questions that come out of these technological developments, right? So again, I'm gonna go back to deepfakes, because when we're talking about tech and democracy, it's so important for us to be able to have access to accurate information and to be able to tell the difference and to be able to resist that kind of manipulation that is made possible by these very convincing, misleading and disinformation campaigns. So I think the research and really identifying what the new research questions need to be going forward and the diversity of perspectives are the things that the universities, I think, are uniquely positioned to bring to the conversation.
Thank you. Deirdre?
So I'm going to actually shout out to Charlton, who you shouted out to before. In an earlier conversation, I was talking about the importance of placing technology in history and placing data in a historical context. And I think one of the most important things we can do for our technical students or our data science students is to give them multiple lenses through which to view the work that they do, the historical, the ethical, right, the social, the political, understanding the political economy of a new data infrastructure or of a new technology, understanding how it is going to reorient power or re-solidify it, right? I think those lenses, helping them like think critically, is one of the most important contributions that we can make in thinking about preparing the next generation. If you look at the AI competencies document that we developed as to support the AI talent surge, one of the other things I was very involved in was a cross-government effort to bring new AI and AI-enabling talent into government. And that AI-enabling certainly includes data scientists, but it also includes people who do more of the socio-technical work or the tech policy or the privacy and technology sort of work into government. And if you look at that AI competencies document, the technical competencies include socio-technical perspective, actually having an understanding of what does it mean to not just be viewing technology as some static thing, but to be analyzing it as part of a broader system within an organization, within a task, to be able to actually think about how it's going to interact with the policies and processes and humans that it is going to be both used by and used on. Two, it emphasizes values and design, right? An emerging part of the design field, which is thinking about things like designing for justice, designing for privacy, designing for equity, and putting not just efficiency and how quickly can I do a task, making those questions central in the process of designing and developing the system itself. And then finally, an emphasis on testing and evaluation along all those dimensions, not just speed. And so I think that's like, you can really see the ways in which the kinds of skills that are required to really think about using technology in the government context where you have to serve all the public, right? You are serving a public mission, not a business opportunity, and you have to serve every member of the public. And in order to do that work well, you need to be centering the public and how the system's going to impact them. And you have to be centering not just their needs, but also their rights. And I think that document gives you some sense of the different kinds of competencies that I think we need to make sure we inculcate in our more technical students in order for them to really step in and be leaders and to be effective, whether it's in delivering services to the public or in designing the next generation of tech policy.
Thank you so much. Okay, now I think we have a few minutes for questions. If there's anyone in the audience who has anything that you'd like to ask.
So I know there is not much time, and I agree with all what you were saying about the literacy portion in colleges and students, but I find often that some of the deepest problems in democracy is the illiteracy, not in colleges, but in a lower grades. So how would you, as part of your organizations, are tackling that from the roots, to ensure that that democracy can be fulfilled in the college stage? Thank you.
I can't actually talk for Berkeley, but I can tell you while I was in the administration, the Office of Science and Technology Policy, part of the science and society portfolio, includes an emphasis on STEM education, and that includes both a real lens on equity, who has access, how are they getting in, but also thinking about STEM education, including things like kind of the competencies to understand when people are trying to lie with statistics and right, like that sort of stuff, all the way through the pipeline. So there definitely are kind of like broad efforts at the federal level to think about STEM education.
Yeah, and I think you're absolutely right that we can't wait until they get here. It needs to start much earlier. One thing I will say about this is that we've just had an election, but civic engagement is more than just voting, and it doesn't happen just every 4 years, right? So finding ways for students at the lower grade levels and in higher education to connect with the problems that they see in their community and to feel empowered to do something about it is, I think, really the most important thing, because you may have heard, you may have seen that our politics are pretty polarized in this country. At the moment, and not just this country, right? We're seeing this in many countries around the world, and that kind of polarization is really off-putting to many people, and they don't want to participate in that, right? It's mean, it's nasty, and so giving people, again, those tools to start building that civic efficacy and commitment to what is the public good, even understanding the concept of the public good and public interest from those very early grade levels, I think is absolutely where we need to focus much more attention than we currently do.
Are there other questions? We can take probably one or two more. No? Want to make sure? Okay. There's one back there.
Thank you. Is it on? All right, thank you. My name is Francisca Richter. I'm at Case Western Reserve in Cleveland. And going back to the video and how we started, it reminds me also, this effort and this joint network that has been built reminds me of the Underground Railroad. And especially with the challenges that we might be facing now, where in some universities already we're hearing that they cannot use words that refer to the history of this country regarding racism, discrimination. I would like to get your thoughts as to how this network is going to be operating openly, transparently, but also in a very smart way so that it can continue to do the work that it needs to do.
So I think governments at all level both have a commitment to kind of serving their populations. And I think designing technology and using data in ways that ensure that you're delivering services to your full population are things where there is like a high level of agreement. And so I think that there is much work that is happening in the PITUN that is attractive generally to, no matter how you felt about the election or where you stand on different issues, the idea that, when COVID hit and you were a mom with a vision disability and all of a sudden all of the information that you needed to help your kid learn or to find out anything about what was happening on the school went online, and it was not designed in a way that allowed you to use assistive technologies to access it. I think everybody agrees that's a problem, right? Like that is something about just like delivering basic services to the public. And so I think much of our work about kind of building the fabric of democracy, when you talk to people, like many people, they want to treat other people the way they want to be treated. They want systems to work for everybody. I am an eternal optimist, but I do think that building robust digital infrastructures and using technology in a way that aligns with our vision of serving the public and serving the public good is something where there's a lot of agreement around. And much of the work that is so important that this community's research feeds into happens at the state and local level, not just at the federal level, and also is dependent upon technologies often that are fielded by the private sector. And I think there are many ways and many places where visions of rights and justice remain very vibrant and very much animating principles in the work, in addition to kind of the baseline access.
I see we're at time. So humbled that I had this opportunity to engage in a conversation with both of you, Deirdre and Melinda. So please join me in thanking our